Morning, church. Good morning.
Morning.
Oh, what a beautiful morning it is. The Lord brought the rain last night. And I want to welcome everybody here. Those that are watching on YouTube, we had quite the storm here in our neck of the woods last night. And I was awakened. I don't know if y'all were, but I was. And the Lord began to deal with my heart a little bit on Friday. Typically, on Friday mornings, that's when I visit with inmates. And that's part of evangelizing, of course, and getting part of what our church's responsibility is, not only that camera giving out Bibles, but interceding with those that society has cast aside. And I'm not saying what this man did was right, it was terribly wrong. And he has been incarcerated for quite some time. But Sister Marion, he was so excited. He had the joy of the Lord in his heart when he called me Friday morning. And we visited for the time allotment and the time where we'll automatically shut the call off. But he was so excited because he said, you know, the Lord has called me to evangelize. But not in a church. Not anywhere else. But where the people are hurting. The Lord has even spoke to him on how he wants him to work at Hugh Week going to Teen Challenge here pretty soon. He's so excited because he's getting out. And he kept repeating this over and over and over. He said, Pastor, he said, I want to show everybody that I'm free now. I'm free. Right. He wasn't, yes, he was excited because within 30 days he should be getting out. Brother Keith. But his excitement was, I want to go tell the street, look at me. He's got tattoos all over his face. He lived a very rough life. He'd been in and out of prison most of his adult life. No family. And he said, but I want to go to where the lost are, where the hurting is. That's where we're called. He said, Pastor, he said, the Lord laid it on my heart. How many times have we said this? One soul at a time. He said, that's what the Lord laid on my heart. One soul at a time. He said, everybody's worried about the programs. There's nothing wrong with programs if they're the right type of program. He said, what the Lord keeps instilling on me, it's the individual soul I'm after. I'm after the one. The 99 is here, but go after the one. Amen. And he was so excited. He blessed me so. Friday. And then last night, I come out of that bed. Thunder. Right, seemed like it was right over our house. Boom! And then the Holy Spirit began to deal with me this morning about rain. Nobody can take credit, hear me this morning, for the rain coming down from heaven. Not one man. That is a type of what is going to happen when the spiritual rain falls. No man, no preacher, no evangelist, no singer, no television network will be able to take credit. It's God's doing. Just like they have. Elijah. There was a famine in Samaria for 3 years, church. Hear me. 3 years. Everything was dead. We're in a famine, church. Spiritually speaking, in this nation. 3 years. But the Lord told Elijah, I'm about to send the rain. It wasn't Elijah. It was the Lord telling Elijah. Read the story in 1 Kings chapter 18. The Lord told Elijah, Three words. I see nothing. Sometimes, church, right now in the spiritual famine, that we're seeing what's going on around the country, around the world, that's what we're seeing. Nothing. If we're not careful, that's what we're going to do. We're going to judge everything carnally and not look spiritually unto the Lord. He's the one that's going to send the rain. Go again. The seventh time he would go, he would report back. I see a cloud. Size of a man's hand. That's it. Out of all of looking over the horizon, size of a man's hand. And then what the story tells us. Two things. He repaired the altar. He was at Mount Carmel. He repaired the altar. He had the contest between Satan, if you will, and God, which is no contest. And then glory to God, the rains begin to fall. The Bible tells us that Elijah was at Mount Carmel with his head, his face in the ground, in his knees. Because he was crying out, "Oh Lord, you told me. You told me. You told me to tell Ahab that you were sending the rain." And he would cry out in prayer. And then the rains came. Two things. Prepare the altar. That's the cross. The Lord telling his church, "You look unto me. I've made promises to you." And last night, when that thunder hit, church, that was a suddenly moment. I was awakened out of sleep. I was dead asleep. Boom! And I rose. Woo! Glory, I feel that this morning. Same way the first church was. They were gathered with one accord. And that was a suddenly moment. Suddenly. Something like that. Suddenly! Fire in the fall. They were speaking other tongues as the Spirit gave the utterance. Church, we might be looking out there right now, and you may be saying, "I see nothing. I see nothing, Brother Clayton. I see nothing." Oh, but let me tell you, when there's an inmate that calls me, and I wish I could have recorded it for all of you to hear his voice, I hear the sound. May be the size of a man's hand right now, as far as what we can see. But God is moving on the hearts of people around this world. It has begun. Don't tell me it's not begun, because I heard it. I heard it from that man's voice. He is not the same man. And he was saying, "Oh, I'm ready to go. I'm in the starting blocks, and I'm ready to go." He said, "I want to tell other people what the Lord has shown me. Ye shall know the truth, and the truth shall make you free." And I thank the Lord, because we're starting to see some of the first fruits of that rain. And I'm looking forward to a down deluge like we got. I know what we did in my house. I don't know about y'all, but it was a deluge. I looked outside, and it was coming down in buckets. That's what we need. That's what we're seeking. We're not seeking the blessings per se. The blessings follow the blessor. We need God Almighty moving. We need the Holy Spirit moving in a powerful way, as he did on Pentecost. And I know for the running, it's coming. That's who we're here today. The Lord Jesus Christ. We're here to honor him today. To praise him. To glorify him. To magnify him. To draw closer to him, church. That's why we come together. The fellowship is wonderful. The grandkids, the kids, this fishing and that hunting, all that's great. We draw strength from one another. We encourage one another. We exhort one another. Yes and amen. We're here to praise the King of Kings and the Lord of Lords. Do you love the Lord this morning? I love the Lord this morning. Open your heart this morning. Those of you that are watching at home, whatever you need, he bought and paid for it, Calvary. gathered in one accord as they were on the day of Pentecost. Lord, we thank you for the beautiful rains that came down last night upon our land. That makes the ground fertile, that makes everything grow. Lord, we honor you and we thank you for that sustenance. But Lord, we need you. We need that presence today, oh God. We need a touch from you, oh Lord. We thank you for what you're doing. We thank you for the testimony from Friday. But Lord, we need more of you, just more of you today. We love you, Father, in Jesus' name. Amen and amen.
Amen. Praise the Lord. Let's all just stand and invite the presence of the Lord in here this morning. We're going to sing this little song. And we're going to sing things in grace, I think, after a while, Lord willing. But this song is about that song. It's, you'll understand more what it's saying. Well, I've heard them sing, he paid the price and Jesus bore it all. I've heard them sing, I'm coming home and hearing my call. I've heard them sing some modern songs and songs of long ago. But amazing grace, how sweet the sound, the sweetest song I know. Amazing grace, how sweet the sound, a sweeter song could hear me back.
You would take my place. Rain. You set your treasure in jars of clay. So take this heart, Lord, I'll be your vessel. The world to see, your life in me. Amazing grace, how sweet.
costly plans I made, somehow always go astray.
Here.
I can relate to Paul and say that I feel like I'm the chiefest of sinners.
Yes.
I know God's grace has no boundaries, and I thank God for that.
Amen.
If he'd had boundaries, I'd have crossed over.
That's right. Same here.
But I want to sing this song. It's called Trophy of Grace. And if God's grace could be wore out, I'd have been worn out. It can't be.
Amen.
All the love that comes my way. is relief. How precious did that grace appear. Gee, I first believed my chains are gone.
Children, come unto me this day, for I am here. I have seen thy cry, and I've heard thy praise, and I am in thy midst. My children, look unto me, I say again, unto me and me alone, for I am with you. I will never leave you nor forsake you, for I am with you in the dark night. I am with you in the morning. I am with you in all light, in all darkness, for I will never let this day. Thank you, Lord.
Burst forth, and we will continue to pray, Brother Fletcher. I feel that this morning.
save us. Yeah. Only God can turn this nation around. Only God can turn a family around. Only God can turn a church around. Only God can touch this whole community.
Yesterday. You know, like I said, just to get to the point, my scripture was mainly was dealing with Peter. You know, there was no closer disciple than walk with God and walk with Jesus than Peter. He was mentioned more than any disciple in the Word. He caused more problems and more heartaches and more headaches to the Lord. And I can say, I tell the Lord every day that, Lord, I'm a Peter. I'm as hard-headed. I got a temper. I'll fight you just as fast as Peter. And I said, but the Lord has to deal with me every day just like he does Peter. But you know, you read in the scripture talking about, you know, even as close as Peter was with the Lord, he ate with him, he laid by him at night, he seen him perform miracles. But you know, over in the book of Luke, I'm going to just read this real quick, in Luke 22, verse 31 and 32, he said, Simon, Simon, behold, Satan hath desired to have you to sift you as wheat. Right. But I have prayed for thee that thy faith faileth not. He put that in my heart this last couple of weeks about our faith. And I'm talking about Christian people, not non-sinners or people that are lost or have no concern. But he put it in my heart this morning that, is your faith really where you think it is? You know, we can get up here and praise the Lord this morning and tell you how much we love the Lord and how strong our faith is. But you know, when there ain't no trial going on in your life, the only way to test your faith, and the only way I found in this word to test faith is through trials.
That's right. Amen.
Job said, unless I be tried and come forth as fire. But you know, you got to be tried. I said the Lord I was thinking on this last night and reading. You know, the Lord, we all like the mountaintop experience. There's no Christian that doesn't enjoy that time of peace and joy in their life. But you know, the Lord told me last night, speaking in my spirit, He's not so much concerned about our mountaintop experience. He's more concerned about our valley, our walk in that valley. That's where we're listening to Him, and that's where our faith is being built and strong, is in the valley in the trying times.
That's right.
Like I said this morning, we could sit here, and I had titled this, The Proof's in the Pudding. Well, I told the men yesterday that sounds kind of a funny title. But I believe if you take it in the heart of what the Lord's trying to say, it'll take on a new meaning. Because the proof's going to be in the pudding. The old saying is when the rubber hits the road, that's when the proof's in the pudding to find out where your faith is. Because I tell you right now, there ain't one of us here this morning that couldn't get a phone call after we leave this church that could destroy everything you've ever believed. No matter how anchored you think you are this morning in the Lord, something could happen that would make you sit down and doubt everything you've ever believed. Yeah. And it happens to millions of people all the time. And I said the worst person to try to win back to the Lord is somebody that's been faithful and true to the Lord and they lose a loved one or get a doctor's report and they lose faith in God. And they blame God for what has happened in their life. But I tell you this morning, there ain't one of us here or one of us watching that can't happen to. If you face sooner or later, your faith's going to be tested. Amen. If it's not never tested, you better start looking and you better start seeking the Lord and wonder what's happening.
That's right.
Because something's wrong.
Right.
Brother Swagger said it best, I said yesterday. He said, we're either coming out of a trial or we're going into one.
Yeah.
But if you're not, if Satan's not coming against your life, you need to get on our knees and start wondering what's happening. You say, Brother Clay, that sounds crazy. But I'll tell you what, if the devil's not attacking your life this morning and your family, you better examine your walk with the Lord.
Right.
Because you're not causing him no problems.
Right.
These people out here fishing and hunting and doing all this morning, they're not bothering Satan. He ain't bothering them.
Right.
He's already got it. It's the ones that get up in here and preach and stir up the gospel and get out and witness to people like Brother Green with that man Friday. Different ones. And Brother Marley with his... is using this to make a testimony. That's an awesome thing, you know, to get out.
Yep.
But Satan, that's the ones he's worried about.
That's right, brother.
He ain't worried about the ones that's already lost out here this morning, that's riding up down this road. They're standing down here at this store this morning when you go down here to get lunch after church. There's 25 or 30 people standing there watching their watch, not waiting for church to be out. They're waiting for 12:01 so they can pay for the case of beer they got in their hand. Satan ain't worried about them this morning.
Right.
He's got them where he wants them. He's got them blinded this morning.
That's right.
But I tell you, he's worried about the ones that sit in his church and show up every Wednesday at the prayer meeting on Tuesday and show up on Sunday. That's the ones he's worried about.
Amen.
But I'm telling you this morning, faith and life saved. But I tell you the one that's going to make it. I'm thinking about that statement last night that life does. They have a commercial that says life happens to everyone, and that's true, saved or unsaved. But I felt the Lord speaking my spirit in the book of Luke also. He said what's going to make the difference in your faith is those that got, when they all come through the storm, and the battle has come, is those that got their hands still on the plow, and they're still holding to that plow. Yeah. Because he said if you look back, he ain't got no need for you, because Brother Marlon, you ain't worthy of the kingdom of God this morning. Yeah, it's one thing to come in here, and it's a beautiful thing to get saved and filled with the Holy Ghost. But I can tell you, all y'all, I'm the youngest one here today, and I said, y'all, I can tell all y'all, that's the easy part. I tell people about deer hunting, I said, the easiest thing about deer hunting is shooting a deer. That's when the work begins. Then you got to drag him out, skin him, and clean him, and cut him up, process him. That's all the work. That's the same way about like serving the Lord this morning. It's easy to come down here if you're willing to come down here and get saved and filled with the Holy Ghost. But it's that walk that's going to make the difference.
Come on, amen.
It's that walk when it's all said and done. Ain't none of us made it. I don't care how long we've been serving the Lord. Ain't a nary one of us made it until He says, "Welcome my home, thou good and faithful servant."
Yes, right.
You know, we were talking yesterday in me and breakfast about Donnie. Most all of us know Brother Donnie died here a while back. And, I actually grown up with him and all his brothers and sisters and all of them. But, you know, they're just telling a testimony of it. But, you know, that's wonderful. That did a lot of peace in my heart. I thought about that. I went fishing yesterday, and I thought about Donnie the whole time. I thought about that testimony. But I thought about the sad thing about it is that he threw away this whole life that he had here.
Yes, he did.
I know that don't matter once you cross over that line. But what Brother Marley, what the people he could have reached. He'd have made that decision way before him. Yeah. But you know, there's people out there this morning that ain't going to have a chance Donnie had.
Right.
That ain't going to have a chance to a few minutes, an hour, whatever, before you on your deathbed. I have a family member that's a pastor in our family in the Church of Christ, you know, and they don't believe in bedside repentance. They don't believe it.
Right.
If you don't have works, you know, and the Word does say that faith without works is dead. That's in trying your faith. That's not in what you do. That's nothing in what you can do. They believe you got to do these five or six things before you can get to heaven or get saved. And I ain't found that Brother Green in my word yet. And if I missed it, maybe you can show me after church where I'm sitting seeing it at. It ain't in there.
It's not in there.
But I just come this morning to just stir our faith up this morning. To make sure that we're anchored in our faith. Because it's all, well, Jesus even said in His word. And I'm not saying there's any here this morning. I hope there's none of us here this morning. But He said there's all kinds of them this morning. The churches all down here that praise me with their lips this morning.
Yeah.
That's one thing. But their heart is far from
them.
It's easy to get used to coming in here and praising the Lord and singing a few songs and amen in the pastor every once in a while and walk out of there just as lost as you was when you come in there. You're no more anchored than nothing in this world. And I'll tell you, like I said, as far as I was concerned, Brother Green could just kept on going what was going because the Spirit's moving, ain't no sense in doing nothing else.
Right.
As far as I'm concerned, but I said, most of y'all know I went on vacation last week. Yeah, I get this last week. I've been out of town so much this month more in my whole life. We had a wonderful time. My kids took me off. And I stayed gone 4 days. I didn't have to spend a nickel on nothing. They bought everything I had, everything I needed, stuff I didn't even need. So we made it back home Monday evening, and all was good. And I could, but the Lord, the whole time, dealing with me about this message about my faith. And I got up Tuesday morning, just like I always do. Went on to work, just like a normal day. Still thinking about my trip and where all I had been. And I got a phone call on Tuesday talking about how you tested your faith. Well, you know, the first thing to back up, the Lord said you can preach a sermon on faith, but can you live it? Let's see how true it's going to be. So I get a phone call Tuesday where I got my house, my truck, my land all financed. They don't want to carry my note anymore. They give me a choice to either repo my stuff or I got to pay it all off. Well, anybody knowing me, I can't afford these thousands and thousands of wind out of my sail. It may not bother nobody else, but it bothers me. I ain't got much out there, but what I got is mine. And it just broke me down. I didn't say nothing about it at work. I went on and worked all day and just didn't know what to do. Well, I come home, my truck's gone. So I make a phone call, it's 5:30. I can't call nobody. So my truck's gone. So I just sit down and I'm thinking, what in the world? You know, what am I gonna do? I got a vehicle, I got a company truck, that ain't mine. I could get fired tomorrow, that's it. I said, what in the world am I gonna do? I wasn't as bad worried about that as I was my home and my land. It's been in our family since 1865, since the middle of the Civil War. We have documentation showing. And I sat there and I didn't say, ain't no need telling nobody. I'm not one of these to call somebody and tell them all, because you ain't got the answer. Unless you got about $60,000 you along me, you ain't got the answer. So there's no need to be calling you. And I just went on that evening. I sat there and I didn't sleep that night. I stayed up all night, just sick in my stomach, don't know what I'm going to do. And really don't have no way to buy another truck or anything else. And, you know, my dad told me years ago when I started working and stuff, he said, son, whatever you do, I always pay your truck note. The difference comes between your house note and your truck note. I always pay that truck note because you can live in that truck. That truck will get you to work. You lose that truck and you won't be long, you'll lose your house and everything you got because you can't get to work. But like I said, that wasn't so much so bad. I stayed up all that night, just didn't know what to do. Went on to work Tuesday, worked all day just like I was supposed to. I ain't said a word. It just gnawing on me. Come in another night and I laid there all night long and just didn't see no answer. I thought, what am I even going to do with all this stuff? It'll take 15 semi-trucks to haul it out of here. I said, well, the only thing I know to do in my mind is to try to sell it. And I owe less on it than what it's worth. I can buy me another truck and I can always find another place to live. But I said, it just made me sick. I said, I don't want to do this. You know, I bought this place fair and square, but I bought it because it was my dad's place and the way he grew up. And I just was sick. I just prayed and I prayed and I prayed. It seemed like the heavens was closed, Brother Green. I might as well just been praying to that sheetrock. It felt like as high as it was getting. Right. And you know our adversary, the devil, though, he ain't quiet. When the Lord gets quiet on you sometimes, I ain't heard Satan ever shut up in one time.
Right.
So now he's talking to you. Brother Marlon, Brother Marlon just kept coming up to me this whole time while I was going through this. I don't know why. Just because of your testimonies, I guess I've heard in your life and over the years. You know, and I could hear Brother Marlon saying something. Almost like I would ask him a question or say something to him, and he'd say, well, brother, I can tell you this. I could hear him talk in my mind. And it was good to help, you know. And I sat there, but I ain't going to lie to y'all. I'm 51 years old. Grown man, I have fought men. I've never been whooped a day in my life, and I have fought in every bar and club and all over this freaking country right here. And I just didn't know what to do. I was just literally sick and scared to death. I just kept sitting there, and Satan said, yeah, and you want to get out and preach to people. Yeah, we already know that was a joke. That ain't nothing been done. You ain't touched nobody. You ain't helped nobody. Said your own family wanted, when you started preaching, they all quit coming to church with you. He said, now the Lord's going to take everything you got away from you. I said, he's going to take your truck, he's going to take you home. He said, you're going to leave here walking. And at 1:30 in the morning, I want to say, I guess it's been Thursday morning, I'm still laying there wide awake, and I don't even know what to pray about no more, Brother Green. I just like, all the churching and all that in the world didn't seem to matter.
Right.
I sat there and I sat up in that bed. It made me think when you said you jumped up in that thunder. And I heard that too myself this morning. But I sat up in that bed, Brother Marlon, about 2 o'clock in the morning. And I said, I'm going to tell you what, devil. You might be right. I don't know tomorrow. I don't know 5 minutes from now what the Lord's got planned for me. His thoughts are not my thoughts and his ways are not my ways. I said, but I tell you what, Todd. I said, whether I have to leave this place walking up with a bag of clothes on my back, and that's all I got left. I said, I tell you what, if everybody calls me to come preach the next day, I'll I'll be there for you. Oh, praise God. Oh. I'm going to tell you like Job, all this ain't nothing but junk. I said, the Lord giveth it, the Lord taketh away. But I said, I'll let them know, Lord, this morning, I'm going to praise you no matter what.
Amen.
I said, we can't only praise him when he's blessing us, brother, with everything. You know, like I said, a lot of this stuff, God knows. He said, I have know of what you have need of. I know you need to eat and have a place to sleep. He knows that stuff. But there's times also, so you're going to say, well, I'm going to see what you're going to do. I said, Lord, I tell you what, like I said, I talked to the Lord myself. I said, I'm going to leave this hill, Brother Earl. If I have to leave here broke as a hang as I was when I pulled up here, I'll walk off this hill, and wherever God leads me, that's where I want to go. But I'm going to stand up and tell people my job, and I'm going to tell people behind this pulpit that you need to serve the Lord, or you're going to go straight to hell is what's going to happen. And then I said, my family may look at me, and then the devil, he comes on in and starts saying, yeah, now your family, you done lost everything you got now. You ain't got nothing. You'll leave this place walking with your head hung down. Now your family's going to say, boy, what kind of preacher are you? God called you, didn't you? Look at the shape you in. I said, brother, I said, Satan, let me tell you something. I'm not, my family knows it too. I'm no more interested in what nobody thinks of me than a man in the moon, and I never have been. I said, all I'm worried about is what he knows about me. I said, there's three kinds of words today, one of us. I said, there's a person that people say you are, Brother Marlin. There's a person that you think you are, but there's that one person that God knows who you are.
Yeah.
Amen. He knows I ain't good. Yeah. He knows I'm rotten. That brother sing that song a while ago, that trophy of mercy. Oh, praise God, that's what I got this morning.
Yeah.
If I had to walk out of here butt naked with all I had on me, I tell you what, I got a house in heaven. I'm going to cross that burning gates one day. But I got up and went on back to work Thursday morning because I still got to do what I got to do. And I'm just sitting there all day just, I think everybody could tell something because I got quiet. I mean, if I'm quiet, something's wrong, you know. And I said, well, somebody texted me, the law people texted me about something. And they said, well, you may check with so-and-so over in West Monroe. You may check with them. A lot of times they'll come in and they'll redo that. They'll buy that loan or so. I don't know how it all works, and they'll do it. So I said, all right. So I called a lady and made me an appointment. She said, yeah, I'll be in here at 2:30. Well, look at what you got. Sit down and talk to you. Well, that made me feel a little bit better. At least we're moving in the right direction. Just before I walked into that place, I guess it was Friday, I don't remember what day it was, but I said, Lord, I just want you to know right now before I walk in here that whatever they say, if I walk out of here with nothing, I'm still going to serve you. I'm still going to pray you no matter what. That stuff don't mean, I love it, but it don't mean nothing to me. It ain't nothing in that hill, nothing in this place, Brother Earl, worth going to hell for, not one thing this morning. I went in there and I brought all my junk and I set it down. And like I said, I don't hardly know 2 + 2, so I don't know nothing about all of it. I said, here's the situation. This is what they said. This is what I got. And I said, I don't care about none of it but my truck and my house. That's all I care about. All the rest of it I could care less about. They went off, you know, and did their little thing on their computers. And they come back in there and said, well, sir, do you want your truck back? I said, yeah, I need my truck back. I said, I got to get make a living. If something happens to my work truck, I'm walking. I'll lose my job and everything. He said, that ain't no problem. He said, we'll have it back to you by Monday. And he said, we got to looking at what all they had you charged with. Oh, he said, they got you up in there with $60,000 you owe. He said, I went in there and I redid it all and looked at it and what they owed and what you owed on the house and the truck and what you had. And he said, I'm going to tell you something. He said, we're going to redo it for you, man. We're going to take care of it. And he said, we found out that we can knock $22,000. Praise God. You're in charge of paying way more than what you had to pay. And he said, I just want you to go up front and meet with the lady. said, that lady, she was real nice lady, real Christian lady. She was just talking, and I was just kind of making small talk to take the edge off, you know, because I still ain't sure if it's true or not, you know. And I got to listening to her, though, when she was writing, she was typing it all up. I got to listening in the background while she was doing all that, that song, and there was a song playing on the radio. He said, "Let me tell you about my Jesus." And Sister Peggy, let me tell you about my Jesus. I'll tell you what, Brother Green, I could have had a real play in that place. Let me tell you this morning about my Jesus. Amen. Yeah. You said, what are you trying to say this morning? I'm trying to say when the devil comes in, just remember, let me tell you about my Jesus.
Oh,
Lord. Yes, hallelujah. My God, he's faithful. It ain't about just putting that money in that box over there. Yeah, that's part of it. We should do that. But let me tell you, whether you ever put a dime in that box or not, he still died on a cross. And we should go free this morning. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. And he said, I'll make the latter days better than the former days. Amen. Praise God. And I said, what a testimony. I went out in that truck, and I hardly could contain myself. I said, Lord, I'd just like to hear that song one more time. Let me tell you about my Jesus.
Amen.
Let me tell you what he can do. It don't matter who you and what you know, brother. It's who you know.
Amen.
I said, in my mind and my life, and as far as the devil's concerned, I ain't nothing or nobody. But let me tell you something this morning. I'm a trophy of grace this morning. My name's written in that Lamb's Book of Life, and everybody else is up there with kings and queens and whoever else they are. I may be the least among them. I wouldn't want to stand over that synagogue and that temple. Beating on my chest, Brother Martin. I'm like Peter when Jesus got in that boat. After Peter had done left him, after that Jesus, and Peter said, you need to stay away from me because I'm unworthy. That's me this morning. And I'm going to remain unworthy because it's not on my merit I'm going to get there.
Right.
It's not on who I am or what I am, but it's on him this morning.
Oh,
and I just got up this morning to tell you a testimony that he's still alive and well this morning.
Yes, he is.
And he ain't caring about what everybody else thinks and what everybody else wants to do in your life. But I come to tell you this morning, we all got trials. No, no, there's trials going to be coming. If we keep living and we keep serving the Lord, something is going to come.
Amen.
That's the only way we're going to make it. But I tell you what, and people would, you know, the devil would speak to my mind even after that happened. And I was headed home, and he said, well, if you was a Christian like you said you was, you wouldn't have never feared the Lord. You wouldn't have never got scared and doubted to start with. I said, let me tell you something, Satan, I done proved that you a liar.
Woo.
And the father of.
Yes.
I said, my Lord knows my shortcomings. I said, my Lord knows my shortcomings. But I said, I'm going to tell you what, I had some shortcomings. But I said, the minute I believed it, I got on my knees out there, I got in that truck, and I said, Father, forgive me, forgive me, Lord God. But I said, I have faith, Lord God, but help me with my faith, amen. Help strengthen my faith. If I did come up short and fail, and I did get worried and concerned about it, Father, forgive me. And I know right there from that instant, Brother Ronnie, there's no record of it in heaven nowhere this morning.
Oh.
But there's a record up there this morning that said, God, I'll help you anytime. Brother, I'll tell you this, son, I told you I'd be with you till the end. I'm a friend that's sticking closer than a brother. And I tell you what, I just couldn't believe it. A man walked in there and say, we found a $27,000 mistake in this that you shouldn't even be having to pay for. I said, that means that if you'll keep paying this, what you've got to pay every month, you'll be, in less than 5 years, everything you own in the country will be paid for.
But
I said, praise the Lord. And I went to testimony. I backed up when he told me that he was on his little computer doing his stuff, and he told me that. I said, well, I'm going to tell you something, one thing. I said, the Lord is able.
Amen.
I said, I don't know how. I can't explain to Brother Green how it happens, how he does. I don't even know how we get saved or how he hears your prayers. I couldn't tell that to nobody. I'd be lying to him if I did. But I tell you what, the proof's in the pudding this morning.
Yes.
Amen. And I know we know that, but I'm going to tell you what, the Lord just, I don't know what each one of us will face the rest of our lives, how long we got to live. If we live another day or 15 or 20 more years, trials are going to come.
Yeah, right.
But I tell you what, like I said, I'm not lifting up Brother Martin. I'm lifting up his testimony.
Yeah.
because it would come, I could hear it back in my mind. There's something that Brother Martin had said some time ago that I remember that talking about, oh, the Lord brought me through it. I ain't saying Brother Martin was A1 on top of everything all the whole time. I'm sure just like me and anybody else, he had shortcomings and doubts and fears.
Right.
But he's sitting here today because he can look back and say, well, you know what, now, I don't know, there may be some words ahead of me. But I tell you what, I can look back on this situation and say, did he not do that? Did he not provide for that? That's the only time I can tell him, the Lord wants us looking behind us. Brother Green, maybe every once in a while the Lord wants you to stop and look back and say, well, I was over here. I was stayed up for 3 nights crying and didn't know what I was going to do. And you know, and I said, I was worried about it. I said, how am I going to look to my church family? How am I going to look to my family? You know, here you are, supposed to be anointed and called to God, and then look, you done lost everything in the world and ain't got a place to go sleep or nothing. But I feel like it made it not to lift me up. But I feel like Brother Earl, the yoke broke. When I got up that morning, I let the devil know I don't care what I got to do. Like I said, I'll walk off his heel out here and I'll never look back. But he's still my Lord and Savior. I'll walk over that hill praising his holy name because I know where he brought me from. I know, just like Brother Martin said sitting there yesterday, the same way. I'd be in hell right now. It's not a guess whether I'd be in hell or maybe I'd be there. That's where I'd be, Brother Martin. Because I live a life that send you straight to hell. I've done things that are deserved to me to hell. But his mercy and grace set me free. Hallelujah.
Praise God.
Hallelujah. When I come by this church that day, and Brother Green come up here, that wasn't no accident. Neither one of us know why we was here.
Right.
But I tell you what, I'm glad to say that both of us, me and Brother Green, had a little bit of enough country sense to be led by the Spirit and go and do what he asked us to do.
Yes.
Brother Gray said, I come up here, I had things to do at the office. He was running his business then. I didn't know why I was up here. But then a few minutes later, he knew every reason why he was up here.
Right.
But I'm thankful that we have a pastor this morning that'll get up and listens to the man of God, listens to the Lord and what he's got to say.
Amen.
You know, Brother Ronnie made a comment yesterday. People come into church here visiting, and that's what we want them to do, come in and hear the Word of God. And he said they'll testify when they leave that they felt the presence of the Lord. But Brother Ronnie said, I don't understand it, how they can come in here and come from a dead place where they ain't felt the Lord, and come in here and feel the presence of the Lord, and then you never see them again.
Right,
they
right.
never come back. He said, that's why I left the church I was in, because I wasn't getting fed. And when I found the Spirit of God, that's where I go to get fed. That's why I kept going, and I kept having a hunger. And I just believe that these people have got to a place in their life, Brother Fletcher, to where they're hungry in their heart.
Right.
You've got to have a made-up mind.
Yeah.
But I'm going to tell you this morning, as we all know, and whoever may be watching, that you've got to have a made-up mind. And only you can make that mind up.
Yes.
The Lord can't do it for you, your wife, your family, or nobody else. You've got to have a made-up mind. It's so easy to get discouraged. I don't have to tell you, y'all live longer than I have. Y'all know, y'all. Know way more about all this than I do. I don't care if I've been in it 5 minutes or 10 years. I'm going to let you know one thing. Somebody tells you they seen Brother Clayton down here doing something and he wouldn't serve the Lord, you'll know it's a lie. You'll know it's a lie from the pit of hell. Because every breath I take, every day, is because of him. Because I could be where billions and millions are this morning. It breaks my heart that I invite my family here not to hear. I don't care if they come to hear me say nothing. But I want them to get in that presence that was here this morning, Brother.
Yes, brother.
I don't care if I'll sit right back there and the Lord can tell you it's my witness. I sat right back there and said, Lord, I ain't got to get up there. Don't even let me get up there and say a word this morning. But the Spirit of God is moving.
Yes.
This is what we come here for.
Yes, right.
Not to hear me, not to hear Brother Green or anybody else.
Right.
We come to feel his presence.
Yes.
I mean, like I said, I believe we could have left long ago and know we've been in the house of the Lord this
Amen.
Morning.
Amen. Yes, praise God.
Amen. Hallelujah. That's what it's about. But he also, you know, people, we are saved by our testimony. But other people that are saved by our testimony, hey, they'll do that for you, he'll do that for him. He can do the same thing for me. There's no respecter of cursing this morning. And I just tell you, I love him this morning.
Amen.
I tell you what, I don't know. I'd like like to drag them all in here by their ears. Bob, we used to get, we was in church and we was kids. My mom would pick you up by that ear, take you out in that foyer, take that high heel off, beat you an inch of your life. You come back up in that church blowing snot bubbles. But I'm going to tell you something, your cousins and your friends, they didn't make fun of you. They didn't laugh. Because you won't know why my head would be dragging them out there in that foyer. They didn't take you out in the parking lot like now where people can't hear you. They warned you to hear you. They just took you out of the sanctuary for respect. You know, they'd have beat you right there where you were sitting. But, you know, they took you out there. And I've been preaching in other little places down there, teenagers and stuff, be up here, and I can see everybody, you know. And they're sitting there in that church on them sanctuary with your Facebook and all this. We didn't have all that when I was kids, but it wouldn't have mattered, Brother Ronnie. Woo, we'd have had a come to Jesus meeting in there. My mama looked over and I was playing on Facebook while the man was preaching. Oh, yeah, we'd have had time out back then. I'd have been laid out. It wouldn't have been in the spirit. I'd have been mama to lay me out on that floor right there. My mama growing up in the old school Pentecost church. She said they'd go to church on Sunday evening. Church started at 6 o'clock. It was 1 or 2 o'clock in the morning, Brother Ronnie, before they got out of there. The kids would be laid out under the pews and sleep on the ground. They up there, they have a church. They swinging bobby pins. They running pews. They jumping and shouting in the Holy Ghost. And all them people had to still get up in the next morning before daylight, Brother Fletcher, and get on the word. They ain't missed a lick of word. But you don't want to know why? It's because they got in that presence.
Oh, that's right.
You know, we got him on the clock. We got the Holy Ghost on the clock. We don't want to admit it, but we do. We want him to show up here. I've heard people say, well, we don't see the Pentecost have a revival. Everywhere you ride around here, the Baptist churches, one thing I'll give them, they got a sign out front, revival. Revivals, revivals, all over. But you don't see the Pentecost, the Assembly of God, anywhere having a revival. People tell me, well, you can't schedule the Holy Ghost to show up on Monday night at 7 for a revival. I said, really? I said, we schedule him to show up at 10 o'clock on Sunday morning. And we schedule him to shut off about 12. I said, so we can't schedule the Holy Ghost? I said, we schedule him to show up on Wednesday night at 6:30. I said, we always got him on the schedule. I said, we give our little hour and a half, 2 hours a week in church and praise the Lord, hallelujah, we got to go do what we got to do. But I'm going to tell you what, that's where we've come up short.
Yeah.
Them old churches, them old school churches like my mom was talking about, them people were hungry for the Lord. And you want to know, a lot of it I believe was, like my mama said, they didn't have money in the bank. They had 8 or 9 kids. There was like 9 of my mama and them. They had 8 or 9 kids to feed. They didn't have food stamps and welfare and all this mess we got now, bank money and driving brand new cars. They had to pray for every bite they put in their kids' mouth. When they stopped in the evening to bless the food, they was literally blessing the food, Brother Marlon, to be thankful they had the food to feed their kids with. Now, you know, I went on this vacation, like I said, and it was good. The kids were perfect. Never one time got onto a kid, not one time. And I said, but I'll tell you one thing I did learn. I didn't say nothing about it, but I just watched. You can learn more sometimes by just watching. Every time you pass a McDonald's, a Walmart, or anything, they stop spending $50 on them kids. I told them, I said, it was just a different thing when I grew up. I said, I told them yesterday, I said, my daddy'd go down here, we'd ride Chatham with him. If we was lucky, he'd even go to Chatham. And we tell him we want a Coke back then, probably 35 cents or so. He said, y'all thirsty? Y'all should have got a drink of water before you left the house. He wasn't going to buy you one, you know. But I said, them kids nowadays, they don't know what it is. It won't for nothing. They went in this park we went in, this Silver Dollar City or whatever. I'd recommend nobody go there under. If you're over 40, stay at home. It ain't for me. It is up one mountain and down another. And I'm not talking about little hills right here. I'm talking about it's a lot of climbing mountains. It just ain't worth it. They go in there and they got this little man, y'all seen them tying balloons, little animal air balloons. $15 a piece for a little hat to stick on your head with a balloon. Oh, they gotta have. There ain't no way in heaven and earth. I'd have been a multi-millionaire walking through there and I'd have bought one. Just a simple fact. I said, what are we doing sitting here? All the kids want one in balloons. Hey, it's your deal. You work for it. They bought them balloons, $30-something for 2 hats. It wasn't 10 minutes later, we're down there waiting for them to get on a ride. I didn't get on none of them with them. We're waiting on them. What do I hear? Pop! Well, my first thought was, Irwin's $15. You know, I got to work a little harder for mine. Well, it was a few minutes later. He went and got his sister's little hat. He done popped his. I heard, pop! So they come off the ride. I watched the kids because they were riding one of the big roller coasters. I said, what happened to your hat? I said, oh, they just popped that $30. You should have wanted it up and thrown it in the trash or where you didn't know where it went. Oh, that's all right. That's all right. Down, you know, we go down the road and give $25 for a little stick with a whistle on the end of it. Oh, Jesus. I said all that, you know, what I brought up made me think about all that. They can't come down here to the house of God because they're scared the pastor's going to want $10. I can tell everybody watching and everybody listening and everybody in this state, my pastor ain't on a dime, you got it. All we want is one soul at a time, like you said. My gosh. Yeah. But the world will use any excuse whatsoever.
Right. Oh, yeah.
But I tell you what, if they've experienced what I've experienced this week, I tell you what, they'd be glad to come up in here and give him everything I could possibly give him. And rake and scrape and try to see if I could get some more. But I'm thankful that we can't earn our way. We can't buy our way. We can't pay our way to get in there. I said it was paid right there.
Amen.
When you need a banker, go to that. When you need a doctor, when the doctor says you got, we can't do nothing we can do for you no more, Sister Peggy, that's the answer right there. You know, I got in a deal a couple of weeks ago with this diabetes. I was talking to my mother. Lord, we like two ram goats. I said, I've been praying so hard, the Lord healed me. I said, I work all day. I work regardless. I can't hardly walk, can't hardly put one foot in front of the other. It can't bend over and pick up nothing. It's like somebody jabbing a knife in my back every time. And she said, well, you don't have enough faith. I said, what do you mean? I said, what measure of faith do I have to have? I only read a warning here. And that was very tired. But I said, what are you talking about? Well, Jesus said, the Word said that Jesus, by His stripes, we are healed. You're already healed, Brother Cliff. You just need to start walking around and start claiming that you're healed. I said, all right. Does that mean I stop taking shots in the morning? Do I need to quit taking my medicine? Since I'm already, oh, no, no, don't quit taking your medicine. I said, well, then I'm confused. No wonder I can't get healed because I'm confused on how this thing works. I said, my ideal, when he healed the blind Bartimaeus, he didn't tell him you could see, but you're probably going to need to go down there and get you a pair of glasses, you know, just in case you need a little extra help. I said, I just don't believe that's I don't believe that's in the Bible. But once again, I said, if you find it, call me or text me the scripture, and I'll be glad to look it up and read it. If I'm wrong, I'll apologize about it. Oh, it just got worse. Y'all just don't have no faith, that's why. Y'all don't have faith. I said, once again, I'm waiting for that measure of faith that I'm supposed to have. Oh, Jesus, she went to screaming on the phone. Screaming. I'm talking about to the loud top of her voice. Jesus said, you are saved, you are healed. And y'all just don't believe. You walk around and start claiming I'm healed in the name of Jesus and you'll be healed. I said, well, I'm going to tell you what I'm going to do. I said, I pray all the time for the Lord to touch me. I said, I don't know about all this blabbing, grabbing, naming, claiming, and all this stuff. I said, but I love you, but I'm going to let you go. I said, because one thing I've learned in my walk with the Lord, I didn't come here to argue the Word of God with nobody. That ain't it. God didn't call me to get up here and argue with somebody. If this book says it's wrong, it's wrong. If that book says it's right, it's right. There ain't no need us adding our two cents to it. Matter of fact, there's a scripture in this Bible that says you don't need to add anything to what I say.
Amen.
And take away anything. He didn't make no mistakes. You know, I was going over to Hodge and they said, I think it's Matthew 29:19, I believe, I could be wrong, where it said, the last thing they recorded in that book of Matthew, though, was where Jesus said, go into all the earth, preaching the gospel, baptizing men and Father, the Son, and the Holy Ghost. Y'all know the scripture. Y'all know where I'm going with it. But they preach that you can't baptize nobody in the Father, Son, and the Holy Ghost. It's got to be in Jesus' name. And the pastor went as far as to say, that scripture should have never even been in the Bible. It should have been taken out of the Bible. That right there is when I started studying, where am I at? Because once again, he said, don't add nothing to my word. Right. The Lord didn't make it. What are we saying? We're saying, Lord, you shouldn't have, you made a mistake. I thought this was inspired by the Holy Spirit.
Right.
Amen. So it's in there for a reason, Brother Green. It ain't in there for me and Brother Green to get up here and say, well, you know, thou shalt not commit adultery, you know, but this little girl I like, you know, I know I'm married. They just shouldn't have put that in the Bible.
Right.
You know, I work with a man that goes to church over here in West Monroe. He openly said the pastor's sleeping with three women in the church and married, and the whole church knows about it. And I said, why in this world would you get up every Sunday and go down there and listen to that man preach when y'all know what's going on? Oh, brother, as long as he's preaching that word, I don't care how he lives. I said, I'm going to tell you something. He's an older man than I am. I wouldn't dare stand behind this pulpit up here this morning.
Amen.
Ain't no way, son.
Amen.
It's only by the grace and mercy of God. God don't strike him down right there. I said, but what kind of hypocrite, demonic mess is that right there to go stand and deal with it, knowing what's going on? I'm not going to get sidetracked, but I want to tell that testimony mainly this morning. And we just got, you know, just don't never think we ever got to the place that we can't be tested.
That's right.
That our walk can't, but also don't get to the place that we, you know, because not only did Peter walk with Jesus, but if you remember, Judas walked with Jesus too. Judas seen the same things Peter seen.
Right.
Talked with Jesus, did all the same things Peter. But we see where his life ended, and where Peter's in. And the bad part about Judas, he's probably realized it now. Even after all he'd have done, if he'd have just went and asked for forgiveness, the Lord would have forgiven.
That's right.
Amen. Because I told somebody that, and they said, I don't know if that's true. I said, you know, when I mention Brother Swaggart, sometimes people will throw up that old mess, you know, about 100 years ago. Oh, I can't go listen to that pastor. He done this and this and this. I said, let me tell you something. I said, Brother Swaggart, I answer for Brother Swaggart, but I said, I will tell you this. You better pray that the Lord forgive him.
That's right.
Because if he ain't forgive him, brother, he ain't too likely to forgive us of our sins.
Right.
And I bet you if the Lord went to digging around in some of our closets, we'd make Brother Swagger look like a choir boy. Amen?
Amen.
I tell you what, the devil's quick to throw it up.
Yes, he is.
You know, the only thing I'm so thankful to that the Lord, Brother Ryan, he said, I'll never remember. It is no more. It's washed in the blood. He said, I cast as far as the east is from the west. You know, if you go as far east or as far west as you'll ever go, and you'll never meet again.
That's right.
Amen. And I just wanted to, like I said, I done sat back there and just said, Lord, the Holy Ghost is moving. I don't want to never try to get in His way.
That's right.
You know, I'm not going to get mad if I don't get to preach. Hey, praise God, we had church of the Lord, but that's what we come up. That'd be what we come up here for.
That's right.
This morning. I love y'all and I'm thankful for this church. The biggest thing I was thinking about here, that whole thing is, you know, boy, you know, well, you just know how the devil works. He had me, drug me through the cold. He said, you want to preach about faith? Well, let's stir something up here and just see how, you know.
Right.
Brother Green, I don't know if I want to have to live everything I ever preached out there, boy. But you know, there's somebody told me one time, them lessons that you pay for, Brother Ron, you'll never forget. Them are the ones you'll never forget. And I love you this morning. And I'm just like I said, let's don't take for granted this morning. I don't care how long we've been in. If we're from the pastor down to the people back in Mendy Carver, we ain't arrived there yet.
That's right.
We ain't arrived. Now we better off, we better than we were. Praise God for that. Thank Him for that.
That's right.
But we ain't arrived there. There's been just as many, Mr. Rogers over there in Alaska, some of y'all may know him, he raised all kinds of exotic animals and different things. I was up at his house one day visiting, he was showing my son when he was little some baby zebras. Now, they got brown stripes on them when they're little instead of white. But his father-in-law, we went in the house for something, and I heard the most vile, foul language scream. I'm not talking about just cussing. I'm talking about screaming cussing, vulgar mess. I said, man, I told Mr. Rice, I said, what? He sent me looking. He said, oh, man. He said, that's my father-in-law. He said, he had a stroke. We had to move him in with us. I said, Lord, have mercy. I said, what is that coming out of his mouth? He said, that man back then was 70, I don't know, 80-something years old. He said, you know, that man's never cursed a day in his life. He had that stroke, and that's all he does. He don't eat, sleep, or nothing. Just sit there, just like that all day. I ain't no way I could have took that man being in my house. I would have had to shot him or something, drug him out in the woods or something. I don't know. But that just startled me. He said, that man served the Lord all his life. I ain't never cussed. I ain't never done nothing like that. Now he had that stroke, and that's... And you know the thought that come to my mind? And we just went on back out doing what we was doing. But the thought come to my mind, Brother Fletcher, is that out of the abundance of your heart, the mouth speaking. I'm not judging that man. That's between him and the Lord. He did gone. I pray the Lord have mercy on him, but I believe that scripture is right. This one, I can hide it within my heart from you or somebody else. But we can't hide it from him this morning. He knows it. He knows, you know, you go to church with people. I seen this up there. I went to church with 300 or 400 people. I know husbands and wives that come in there on Sundays, and they'll sit here. And they'll laugh and pick and love one another and ha-ha and hee-hee with everybody. And the only time they do sit by each other and speak is when they're at church. Any other time, they don't speak all week, or they fight and argue all the way to church and all the way home. Because out of 500-some people in that church up there, I've probably remodeled 500 of them's houses. I've seen a lot of stuff going on. There's a lot of stuff in houses that the preacher didn't get to see. One reason I quit all that is because of that. Because I get to be at your house, and, you know, your little sweet wife is in church. They ain't always acting like that when they get home. And they ain't got that skirt down to their knees. They run around in front of me. They ain't got a skirt on, you know. So they go, what you see in here ain't always what you get. But let's just remember, whatever down the road. We all know that he's faithful, but I tell you, he can work it out. No, I'd have been tickled to just work out what I had. I didn't go in there saying, well, look, y'all, I need y'all to do this and knock about 50,000 off on them kids. I wouldn't have no cocky attitude like that. As far as I was concerned, you could go in there and add a couple to it if you want to. This is what I need to do. If not, when I walk out of here, I got to make some other serious decisions. It was when I walked out of that place, I was going to say, I said, well, I'm going to walk out of here and see what they say. And if it's no better than it was when I walked in there, I said, then when I get in my truck, I said, I'm going to go straight to my pastor's house. I'm going to be here and go sit down. And we just go see. I said, I'm going there just to hear. I was going there to seek the Lord. Right. And see what direction, because I believe the direction I'm supposed to be going in. But we need to get the Lord's focus on what else I need to be doing. But praise God, he's coming there, and that's all we said, you know, he'll show out, he'll show off, show up, and he'll show out.
That's right. Yeah.
I like that man. He said, yeah, they're charging you $22,000-something and all these fees and all this stuff. And he said, we'll knock all that off. He said, we got you down to 41-something. And I said, well, I just praise the Lord because he's worthy. Yeah. I don't serve him for that. But I'm glad when we need a banker, when we need a lawyer, whatever we need, he's there.
That's right.
I can't know how, I can't explain how he works. How is he doing? That man's computer, jiggling numbers around. You know how he does? He sends you to that right person. That person don't even have to be saved, Brother Marlon.
Right.
They don't have to give the Lord the time of day, but the Lord can use them.
Right.
I always say the Lord used a donkey to talk to a man. He can use anything in any way he wants to. You could have some people that hate your guts turn right around and bless you. Because that's what the Lord has for you.
Right.
I love y'all, and y'all have a good day. I'm
Now you know why the Holy Spirit wanted you to come up here, brother. The Holy Spirit was dealing with me, and I'm always trying to make sure that we have our ear to what the Spirit desires. And that's exactly what the Spirit wanted given today, was your testimony, brother.
Yeah.
The testimony needed to be heard by people in this church and those that are watching at home. The Lord spoke to my heart, I believe, the Holy Spirit, when you were talking, brother, about the stroke of a computer key, and they dropped your debt load down by $20-something thousand. The Holy Spirit began to deal with me about unjust balances, unjust weights. You read that in the Old Testament, church, that people would rip people off in this world because they would put counterweights, okay, on the scales of that day to make they appear to be heavier than they were. But when you cried out to God by faith, He set the scale right. The world, whoever it was cheating you. But by faith, when you reached out and said, Lord, I'll serve you no matter what. You had a Job moment at that time. Job's wife said, curse God and die. Job didn't. Job didn't blame God, and neither did you. You went forth by faith, and it's that grain of mustard seed faith Jesus talked about. It's not how much faith, it's what your faith is in. And it's in the King of Kings and Lord of Lords. And I would like y'all to get ready to sing here, like right now, share it. And today, when the Holy Spirit spoke earlier, the Spirit reminded us that a storm is coming. Don't forget that. A storm is coming. Whether it's individually or corporately. And I believe a storm is coming in this nation. And so I don't know exactly what the Spirit meant. But that a storm is coming. But He says, stay under the shadow of my wings. Stay under the shadow of my wings. In other words, His wings will protect. His wings protected you. When you cried out, you didn't know what was going to take place that night. The very next day, you didn't know. Just like last night in that crash of that thunder, you had a suddenly, my brother. Suddenlies are coming for those who believe. For those that have a modicum of understanding that says, Lord, we need a touch from you. Brother Clayton, thank you for that. I want us to go to the Lord this morning as we get ready to close in a few minutes. The Holy Spirit has touched us today. If you didn't feel the Spirit, you didn't want to feel the Spirit.
That's right.
I'm going to tell you right now, I don't know if I'll have three people that come to church Wednesday night because of what I just said. But if you didn't feel the Holy Spirit, you didn't want to feel the Holy Spirit. Because when the Spirit shows up, it's just like right here. You're the vessel. I'm a vessel. And the Lord wants to fill it. It's the Lord that fills this bottle, you see, of that living water, of His Spirit being poured out. Water is a symbol, a type of the Holy Spirit. And this morning, you said it, hungry and thirsty for the Lord. We were hungry and thirsty, and He touched us today. He answered prayer. God is a God that answers prayer.
He is.
Do you love Him this morning? It's what I want us to do. As they begin to lead us in whatever they feel led, let's just praise Him this morning before we leave today. Whether we're here for 10 more minutes or 10 hours, let's just begin to praise the Lord. Come on, guys. Hallelujah.
When you pass the point of weary, is your burden feeling heavy? Is it all too much to carry? Let me tell you about my Jesus. Do you feel that empty feeling? The shame's done all the stealing. And you're desperate for some healing. Let me tell you about my Jesus. He makes a way where there ain't no way, rises up from an empty grave. Ain't no sinner that he can't save. Let me take out my Jesus. His love is strong and his grace is free. And the good news is I know that he can do for you what he's done for me. Let me take out my Jesus. Let my Jesus change your life. Oh, let me tell you about my Jesus. All the wrong turns that you would go and do if you could. Who can work it all for you good? Let me tell you about my Jesus. He makes a way where there ain't no way. Rises up from an empty grave. Ain't no sinner that he can't save. Let me tell you about my Jesus. His love is strong and his grace is free. And the good news is I know that he can do for you what he's done for me. Let me tell you about my Jesus. Let my Jesus change your life. Hallelujah. 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 Amen. Amen. He would care that much about me. Let me tell you about my Jesus. Oh, he makes a way where there ain't no way. Rises up from an empty grave. Ain't no sinner that he can't save. Let me tell you about my Jesus. His love is strong and his grace is free. And the good news is I know that he can do for you what he's done for me. Let me tell you about my Jesus. Let my Jesus change your life. Hallelujah. 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 Amen. Amen. Hallelujah. Hallelujah.
Thank you for joining us. Please join us again. We love you, but more importantly,